Greetings, everyone, and welcome back to our Sky Tonight program. This is Seth Mayo again, curator of astronomy for the Lohmann Planetarium at MOAS. And in this edition of the program, we are covering the dates of September 19th through September 25th. We're going to start things off by talking about the rising of the constellation of Aquarius that we don't get to mention very often. Then we're going to look at a moon shadow transit across the cloudy bands of Jupiter. And we'll end with a highlight of the autumnal equinox, the first day of fall for us here in the Northern Hemisphere. So let's get to it. Now at this time of year in the Northern Hemisphere, if you're looking towards the east, we can find the rising of a rather dim constellation or sky, but one that is well known, and that is the constellation of Aquarius. I don't always talk about really dim objects because of course they're hard to find, but occasionally it's worth finding some of these other groupings of stars that have some interesting history, some interesting objects inside of them, and it's just a fun challenge to be able to find some of these lesser known stars in our sky. Now actually what makes it a little bit easier right now to find Aquarius, and this is in the evening not long after sunset, is it's situated nicely between two planets that have been rising in this area. We have the planet Saturn right here, that's a little higher in the sky once it gets dark, and then below it to the left here we have the planet Jupiter that's also been rising higher and higher and earlier each evening. So in between these two planets there are some stars here that are a little dimmer. In a light polluted area these stars may be quite difficult to find, but if you happen to be in a darker location, you may notice just kind of this light grouping of stars here that kind of come down towards the east there, if you follow along here. And the two brightest stars here, this is the Beta and Alpha stars within the constellation of Aquarius, form Aquarius's shoulders, because this is supposed to be a person, or what's known as the water bearer or the water carrier. So I'm going to turn on the constellation by clicking on one of the stars here and showing the lines of it. I know the lines of it probably don't help that much in figuring out the constellation, like many of them spread throughout our sky, but these are supposed to be the shoulders of Aquarius. He's holding a cup or a vase where he's pouring water down here, and this is part of his body there. Let's put up the picture just to make things a little bit easier. Like I said, his shoulders, his right and left shoulder, are represented by the brightest stars inside Aquarius. And those stars actually have interesting Arabic names as well. Beta Aquarius is also known as Saldu Sud, and that's an Arabic name that means luck of lux. And his right shoulder, this star here, is Saldu Malik. And I may be saying this a little off, a little wrong here, but these Arabic names are associated with luck. I think that star means luck of the king. And the reason for the luck theme here, at least with these two stars, is according to tradition in Egyptian, Persian, and Islamic mythology, the sun would be rising in this part of the sky in the springtime around March, and in what is now modern day Middle East, the rising of the sun at that time of year usually brought the rains and the floods, which was a great time of year for planting and agriculture. And so that kind of lucky time of the year was associated with this area of the sky, since the sun was in this area when it rose in the spring, and those stars around that area were given sort of a luck name to them. Now, of course, Aquarius is known as one of the signs of the zodiac, the 12 signs that the sun seems to move through throughout the time of the year as we go around the sun. And so that's been known since ancient times. And of course, Aquarius does come from Greek mythology. And this character is associated with two prominent figures from these ancient stories. One association is with Deucalion, who is the son of Prometheus, and Deucalion with his wife Pyrrha built a ship to save themselves from a great flood that the king of all the gods Zeus had unleashed on the world since he was angry. And he's famously known for surviving this great flood in kind of a Noah's Ark type story. Another character that Aquarius is usually connected to is someone named Ganymede. And Ganymede was a young Trojan prince who is the son of the Trojan king Tros, who was actually stolen by Zeus because Zeus was infatuated by him, and he became the cup bearer for Zeus on Mount Olympus. So he's known for serving that role for the king of the gods, either Ganymede or Deucalion. So either way, those stories do connect with water. And that's why you see in the constellation, he's holding water and pouring it out. And this area of the sky is commonly known as the ocean or the sea of the sky. There's actually not a lot of bright stars in this area. So it does kind of look like a dark ocean of space. And the constellations around him have a water theme, like Capricorn, the sea goat here. Down here, we actually have Pisces astrinus, which is the southern fish. And in some stories, Aquarius is pouring water into the mouth of the southern fish. There is another famous fish in the sky nearby of Pisces that we find there, another zodiac sign. And even down real low below all of this is a sea monster kind of out of frame here, out of view, hasn't risen high enough in the early evening. Also a sea creature. So a lot of ocean related or sea related characters from Greek mythology. And one notable celestial object I want to mention inside of Aquarius relates to exoplanets. Within Aquarius, there is a very dim star that's kind of hard to find, but it's rather close to us compared to most stars in our sky. So we're going to zoom into kind of where his legs are, at least in the picture in Stellarium here. Let's see if we can find this particular star. Like I said, it's kind of difficult to find here, but if I click on the correct one, we're going to find a star called Gliese 876. This star is only 15 light years away from us. It's a red dwarf star, and it was the first red dwarf to be discovered to have exoplanets around it. And not just one exoplanet. Now we know there are four exoplanets around it, and one of those exoplanets is a super Earth, one that is more than 6.5 times the mass of Earth. But that was significant to find a planetary system with a star that's very close to us and around a red dwarf star within Aquarius, which makes it an interesting area for exoplanet research. So that sits inside of Aquarius here, the water bear or water carrier constellation that we find right now in this area of the sky rising in the east. And like I said, it's in between Saturn and Jupiter, which is quite nice. So again, those stars are kind of hard to find, but it's always worth looking for even the more obscure stars and constellations as they tie to ancient Greek mythology and these stories that we still talk about today. Now, not far from where we found Aquarius in our sky, rising in the east in the evening, just below and to the left of that, we have the planet Jupiter, as we mentioned. But what's nice about Jupiter, especially on Tuesday, September 20th, we have a transit of a shadow of one of its moons crossing its cloudy bands. This moon is Ganymede, which we just talked about. Ganymede is one of the characters associated with Aquarius, so this works quite well. So I'm going to show you what this looks like as we zoom into Jupiter here. And what's nice about Jupiter, it's really big and bright right now because opposition, when we're closest to Jupiter, is coming up next week. So it's a great time to look and view this planet here. So as we get closer in, starting at about 8:10 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time, you can start to see the shadow of Ganymede cross those cloudy bands of Jupiter. Now keep in mind, the shadow transits across Jupiter are very time and location dependent. So for this transit event, the Americas are the best place to see it because that's when Jupiter is in the evening sky and high enough above the horizon when the transit is occurring, and occurring at a decent hour as well. So again, this is starting at 8:10 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time. You do have to adjust for your time zone. If you're in the West Coast of the United States, you won't see this transit event until later on, into the kind of the second half of it. But I'll show you from our location on the East Coast of the U.S. here. So as we move ahead in time, you'll see that transit commence of that moon, Ganymede, crossing Jupiter. And these transits are beautiful. You do have to see them through a telescope to view them, but if you do, it just makes for a spectacular scene. Now, speaking of Ganymede itself, Ganymede is the largest moon in the solar system and one of the Galilean moons of Jupiter. There are four of those Galilean moons, and Ganymede lies third in the order of those Galilean moons. It is very large. It's actually bigger than Mercury. It has 26% more volume, but not as massive as the first planet from our sun. It is a very interesting world because so far we think it's the only moon with a magnetic field. And years ago when the Galileo probe flew by, we realized that there's a global ocean underneath the surface of Ganymede. Maybe more water than Earth has, which is pretty extraordinary, but it's covered in these dark and light patches of material on its surface. And fairly recently, a Jupiter spacecraft called Juno, that's now on its extended mission that was meant to study Jupiter, actually made some close flybys of Ganymede and took some extraordinary pictures of it. So we're getting new imagery of this large, massive moon, the largest in our solar system, around Jupiter, which is pretty awesome. And going back to the transit of Ganymede, this lasts only until about 11 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time. And so as that occurs at that time, the shadow will leave the disk of Jupiter, and then you'll see Jupiter as it normally looks through a telescope. So if you're on the western side of the Americas, especially of the United States, you'll see that latter half of the transit shadow of Ganymede across Jupiter. So that's quite spectacular to find that. And the nice thing is, it's easy to spot Jupiter now rising at a pretty decent time in the east. And you'll see it get higher and higher as the transit commences this Tuesday. And coming up on Friday, September 23rd, we have the equinox occurring. And for us in the Northern Hemisphere, this is what's called the autumnal equinox, which is the first day of fall. If you find yourself in the Southern Hemisphere, this is the vernal equinox, the first day of spring, since of course the seasons are reversed between the hemispheres. So at least speaking for the Northern Hemisphere, our first day of fall here, this is occurring technically on the 23rd if you go by Greenwich Mean Time or Universal Time. Here in the United States, this is occurring actually in the evening of the 22nd. But we'll just say the 23rd is the first day of fall for us. And this is when the sun's path is crossing what's called the celestial equator, as we've mentioned before. And so the sun seems to go up and down in the sky as we go around it. Earth is tilted. And in the summer, the sun is highest up in our sky. And in the winter, the sun is lowest. And the in-between moments during the equinoxes is when the sun is kind of in the middle of all of that. And the equinoxes are the only time of the year when the sun rises exactly east and sets exactly west. And equinox means equal night, so we have about an equal amount of day and night around this time. And then it's gonna transition into less day and more night as we head closer and closer to the winter solstice in December. So this is just a change of seasons as the sun continues its southern trek in the sky. So we're gonna say, happy equinox for everyone around the world. Hey, thanks again for tuning into the program. If you happen to find yourself in Daytona Beach, please stop by the Museum of Arts and Sciences and catch a show in our Lohmann Planetarium. We're running shows daily. If you want any more information about our shows and what we have on display in our museum, please check out our website and tune into our various social media channels. We're posting some great content from all around the museum. Hope to see you back here again. I'll say happy fall or happy equinox, and of course, happy stargazing.